It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world. You're in the sweet spot, baby. You're in the sweet spot, girl. You're in the sweet spot, darling. It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world.
Welcome to the Sweet Spot Podcast. My name is Lynn, and Ken's my co-host. How's it going, Ken?
Oh, it is going. It is going. I'm looking forward to this episode. It's going to be a great, great show. So I'm glad to be here.
This is episode 342.
342. That is amazing.
I know.
That is absolutely amazing, Lynn. That is really commendable. Doesn't seem like any more than 330.
I'm always wondering, should we number the current event shows, or should we just keep, you know, that's my
thing. Let's just keep our numbering system the way it is now.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. So yes, we do have a new format. If you haven't caught on yet, we are doing our main segment, as we called it in the past, with like our main interview or the main topic discussion. We're doing that as its own show, and that is this one you're listening to. And then we have on the other weeks, the off weeks, we have the current events, the latest Disneyland current event news.
Yeah, and it's usually covering stuff that's happened the previous 2 weeks. So our previous episode covered everything that had the two weeks leading up to September 2nd.
Yeah.
And we'll do another one, you know, that'll come out a week, you know, in a little over a week. That'll cover the 2 weeks since September 2nd. So,
yeah. And if you're like, wait a minute, who are these people?
Yeah.
We are these former guys? Disneyland custodial cast members, and we are the hosts of the number one podcast hosted by two Disneyland custodial cast members. Former.
Number one.
Yeah. We are also authors of two books, both titled Cleaning the Kingdom.
Yes.
And we do a discussion online with the... where am I going with this? Okay, so we have a Patreon for people that want to help support the show. And yes. And it's very helpful. We really appreciate everyone. And we have a lot of fun, too, because what we do once a month is for people that give $5 or more a month, you can be a part of our live current event show where you can interact with us via chat. And we will read some of your comments and converse that way. And we do that once a month. And then we also once a month put out a bonus episode that's separate of that that Ken and I record together. And it's just various topics surrounded around Disneyland. And that is part of it also for $5 or more per month. Speaking of that, we have a new Patreon. And we wanted to welcome James Cross to our Patreon.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for your support. And thank you to all the existing Patreon supporters for your support. That really helps out a lot. And helps defray the cost of doing the podcast.
You can just search The Sweet Spot at Patreon, Sweet Spot, or go to our website, thesweetspot.com, and you can, there's a link on there. Also, just in a few days, if you're listening to this the day it comes out, we will be at D23 Expo.
Yes. Right? September, 9th, 10th, and 11th?
Yes.
Of 2022. So for you early listeners, that's where, you know, if you've got tickets, come on by and come find us in the Emporium. We're going to be at booth 206.
Yeah.
And we'll be there with a couple of our friends who also are great authors. And if I do say so myself.
Yes.
We'll have some great books for you to pick up and be autographed.
Yeah. And then the audio version of our second.
It's finally here.
Second book is done, and you can buy the physical copy of it only at D23 Expo
It's exclusive. It's so exclusive. Yeah.
And the first books, well, both of them, they're physical copies. You can take that with you and listen to it on your own via USB drive. And then if we have any left over, we'll put those on the website. We hope we don't, though. But if we do. So then, let's see, anything else we need to mention? Yes, Ken, who is our sponsor?
I did want to mention our sponsor. It's Concierge. They're our magical vacation planning partners. They're at concierge.com, concierge.com. It's kind of like concierge and mouse ears put together. They focus on Disney getaway vacations. So, you know, if you've been listening to the show, you know what we think about them. But if you're new to the show, you really, really need to check out concierge.com to start planning your next Disney getaway vacation, because that's all they focus on. So if you want to go to Disneyland or Disney World or Disney Solani in Hawaii or on Disney Cruise or Adventures by Disney, any of that stuff, that's what they do. They take out all that uncertainty and stress that you would come across with planning a Disney getaway vacation these days, and you really should start planning your next one and go with concierge.com. Tell them that the Sweet Spot sent you, and when you book a package with them, you know, packages like a week on a cruise or theme park tickets with a hotel stay, you know, do that. Book a package with them. Tell them the Sweet Spot sent you, and you might get a special gift. We really appreciate their support, and they're so good. Lynn's working with them now, so you might actually get Lynn if you go with Concierge. So, yes.
Also, I had one more thing I wanted to mention. I was a guest on a podcast called Rope Drop Park Hop, and they're a lot of fun. And I've had a good time talking about the show and just talking about Disneyland. I had a lot of fun. So if I'm going to check them out, Rope Drop and Park Hop Podcast.
Without further ado, who is on this program?
This one?
Yes.
We are going to have a round table of Jungle Cruise skippers. We've done this before in the past. We've had Splash Mountain, that was a lot of fun. It's hard to organize, but it's a lot of fun. and so this one is going to be great. I'm really excited about it. Jungle Cruise is a very popular attraction. It's known for their skippers. And I think we're going to really have a good time. So I hope you enjoyed this also. So let's get right into it, Ken. Okay, for this segment of the show, we're going to bring a whole cast of people on. We've done this before in the past. We had the opening crew for Splash Mountain, and thought we'd continue this and have a whole bunch of skippers on the show. And we have two people that we've had on our show before. We have Alex Stewart.
Hello.
And we have David Marley.
Hello there.
And new to the show, we have Trevor Kelly.
Hey.
And Kip Hart.
Hello. Howdy. Welcome.
Yeah, thanks for coming on the show. This is this technology is crazy. We have six of us, you know, all over the place here. So
all sharing one microphone.
That would be interesting. So I'll just go around and we'll have everyone, you know, explain when they started at Disneyland and like maybe, you know, just some years and stuff. So just to remind everyone, Alex, we'll just have you go first.
Okay, yeah. So I think I was there the shortest amount. I was in 07, 08. So I was right Kip, you and I worked together, which was
That's correct.
Pleasure.
Yep.
Trevor, I think that you quit right before I came on, right?
I was 2000 to 1.
No, 2002.
2001 to 2. Thank you, Dave.
Together.
But I floated around quite a bit, so we probably crossed paths here and there.
Okay, fair enough.
I think I worked there the least. I worked there for 48 hours before I was fired.
You did.
48 hours, that's true.
But to be fair, you weren't wearing pants most of those 48 hours.
I stand by my principles.
It was a religious thing.
I get it.
Pants free since 93, baby.
'93, that's right.
Wow. Okay.
Dave, how long did you actually work there for?
Who?
Dave.
Oh, I worked there in the summer of 96, and then I came back for about 3.5 years in the early 2000s, like early 2002 to late 2004.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, so we all kind of worked together. I mean, we were in custodial, but yeah.
Kip, you've been there since, what, 55? Is that right?
Yeah, I was actually 54. I was actually pre-opening crew.
Wow.
They just found him in a dirt lot.
I was hanging out amongst the trees, the orange groves.
Then he quits for 2 years, then he works for 2 years, then he quits for 2 years.
I was planting trees, and then they said, we need somebody in a boat. So I topped in a boat, and then so I started in 2004. I started World of Disney in 2003, and then I quit with no notice and then rehired 6 months later. And the only place they could think of putting me was Jungle Cruise, which is where I wanted to be anyway. Cool. And then I'm a multiple time rehire.
Offender.
So I just left the company about a month ago.
Oh.
So I did a quiet little last boat, or I just did a last day, and I just, you know, had a lot of fun. But anyway,
I look forward to
collectively about 15 years, I think.
Yeah.
Do people really believe you now, Kip, when you tell them you've quit?
No, they've given up thinking that this is done. although I haven't missed it this time. Usually I miss it pretty bad, but this time I'm pretty content so far anyway. So
you're like a classic rock artist when they say this is their farewell tour,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Like the Eagles, hell freezes over, and
he's
then
like Motley Crue, we're done, we're never coming back, yeah. Except for the next couple tours.
Yeah, you're right.
But whenever the Bills come due, we're back.
Like the Electrical Parade.
Exactly right. Yeah. It's never returning again in case we need money.
If there's one parade that just let that one go. It's sad now.
Oh man.
Can I tell you guys something? I have never actually watched that parade all the way through, even one time.
Wow.
I know.
I did a summer school because I was a bad kid in the 70s when it was a brand new parade, and they, for some reason, we took a field trip to Disneyland, and they took us, we got to see where they launched the fireworks, which were just holes in the ground. Mm-hmm. And then they took us into the building where all of the, they let each of us climb inside Pete's Dragon and like get inside one of the snails and like sit in the, and I'm like, I was 8 and I'm like, why are we in here? This is cool. But I'm also thinking like, what, do they want to make us excited about Disney? Do they not know we're 8-year-old kids and we're always excited?
It's just natural. Yeah. Well, so, to me, there's a lot to unpack there, Dave. I mean, first, you're 8 and you were a bad kid, so you're in summer school at 8 years old.
Yep. Yep.
Can you rewind and tell us like what caused you to become such a bad kid? So what did you do that was so bad that landed you in summer school at 8 years old?
First of all, I'm in therapy, so I don't need more therapists. Second of all, if you're going to charge me, this is free, I'll tell you. Let me tell you the story. I went to the principal's office twice on the first day of first grade for getting in fights. I don't know what the kid did, but I punched him and knocked him on the ground. And then I went to the principal and apologized. And at lunch, he came up to me and made fun of me in front of all my friends. And evidently, the lunch lady heard me after I knocked him on the ground, telling him, I can tell the principal whatever I want, and I'll keep beating you up every day.
And then you beat up the lunch lady.
And then I beat up the lunch lady.
Yeah.
And the weird thing was, I wasn't a bully. I didn't pick on other kids. Just if somebody hassled me, bam, they were on the ground. But I was a talkative kid.
Mm. And that really? That's shocking.
Right? Back when ADHD just meant you were a bad person. Now I get meds and they're like, oh, you've got a condition. In the 70s, it was like, what's wrong with you?
No, that's totally true.
Let's get him a job that involves him being in a cage in the dark all day long.
If only he could focus.
But at the age of eight, my sister took me to Disneyland and I was at the Jungle Cruise and I realized this is where I want to work. I will be a skipper when I grow up. And it was a career goal. At seven. All right.
And that's what that was like a year of awakening for you. First you were enter into Elliot in the Electrical Light Parade, and then you find your life's calling in the jungle.
I literally never put those two things together before.
Are you sure you're not a therapist?
Because, dude, okay.
Wow.
It's $150 an hour. That's impressive. I feel like that should be your memoir title. My Life at Eight. And basically everything is coming back to what happened when you were 8 years old. Have you ever thought about that?
Well, my family makes fun of me because I don't remember anything from my life. So every story starts with, I was 8 or 9, and then I tell the story.
They're like, remember. You were 23.
I was 8 or 9 when I was in the Army, and Dad. Oh, okay.
It's arrested development. That's what that is.
Yeah.
We moved when I was 10, so I knew it was before I was 10. That's how I tracked.
I've heard that people with ADHD, and I suffer from this as well, they have a difficult time. I like to look at my – I think of my memory of my life as that Price is Right game where you have to stop on the price and it's a little red. Uh-huh. That's my consciousness of life memory.
Yeah.
And anything before or after is just gone, wiped clean.
I was told by a doctor, a former student of mine who now has a PhD in psychology, that if I don't get it locked into my long-term memory, it will be lost forever within minutes.
Dang.
Yeah, that's.
How did you remember that, though? That's impressive.
I know. Well, you know, she wasn't yelling at me, but yeah.
It had to be traumatic enough that it actually locked in.
We were fighting at the time.
She was actually a lunch lady at the time.
Right. The principal told me not to fight with her, but then she made fun of me in front of my friends, and that aggression can't stand. So,
and how did that make you feel?
I was a professor for years, and I once said, and how does that make you feel? And the psychology professors were like, you know, you don't talk like that. No one can make you feel any way. And I just looked at the one guy who said it, and I said, I'm pretty sure I can make you feel a specific way if I want to.
What kind of hippie talk is that?
And you punched him.
He doesn't get a cool podcast and a copay, so.
Which, speaking of which, I want to talk about this. I just saw on your guys' social media that you're starting a podcast. Is this something we're able to talk about?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Please do.
Okay.
Please shout it from the rooftops.
Yeah.
We just launched, what was it, yesterday?
Yeah.
Oh, you guys have something. Okay. Tell us, what is it? What's it all about?
It's we try our best to talk about Disney, but circling back to ADHD, that frequently goes off the rails very fast. Mm-hmm, but it's fun. We just kind of sit and chat, and we have topics that we want to talk about, and it kind of veers off into Toontown vomiting and Trader Sam eating the rich and all sorts of fun stuff.
Yep. A lot about Toontown. A lot about vomit.
Yeah.
Code V, as you guys know well.
Yeah, sounds like our podcast.
Oh, man.
Right? This is, if I can say this, and then I'll make the other guys talk. This is one of my favorite podcasts because I am friends with a fellow professor I taught at Cal State Fullerton who worked in janitorial for years. And I kept trying to interview him. He's like, nobody cares about what janitors do.
Yeah.
And so I brought in your book, and I go, and look, they've got a podcast. So when I was on it last time, I sent him the links. I'm like, see, this is important, good stuff that people care about.
Yeah. Okay, so Dave, and forgive me for asking this question. You don't have to answer it if you don't want to. If it brings up bad memories, just please edit it out. But Dave was trying his best to explain to me, what is the magic behind Code V's at Chippendale's Treehouse?
Wait, what? There's magic? Like there's something secret?
Apparently it's a hot spot.
It used to be the acorn crawl next, you know, they had the acorn crawl right next to it, which was just a fancy ball pit, right?
Yeah.
That was where the good stuff was, because then we had to go in there and get all the acorns out of there.
Oh my God.
So that they could be washed. We had to scrub down the artificial dirt, you know, which is really the rubber coating of the pit. And then we would bring in another supply of fresh, clean acorns. I was always surprised we didn't actually find the body of a toddler down there.
Just covered in vomit.
Yeah.
Wait, so what was it about the acorns, the ball pit, that made people just decide to retch?
It's just really exciting stuff, I guess.
I guess. You eat enough acorns.
Little kids get super excited, and they've been on this emotional high all day, and they're eating sugary food, and in the ball pit, they just lose it.
Mm-hmm. It was the nearby popcorn wagon. If they could get rid of all the popcorn wagons in the park, then I think there'd be a lot less nausea.
Okay.
Do you think they'll buy that? You know, I don't know.
Yeah.
If they got rid of the popcorn at Disneyland, speaking for myself, there will be violence.
I'll tell you what. Have you seen a friend of mine just showed me how to make it. have you had the curry popcorn from Tokyo Disneyland?
What?
Ooh. Magic. Mana in a bucket.
So, guys, I got to share my ignorance here. The only curry I've ever had was at a Tokyo Joe's. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it was real curry because it came from Tokyo Joe's. But it was like this coconutty soup thing. Can you break down what a curry is for me?
Japanese
food. Well, I was actually at the Olive Garden. It was curry rigatoni. It was delicious.
Sounds super authentic.
Never in the curry bowl.
I'm sorry. I missed the question.
So what is curry? It's like coconutty thing, right?
Curry
like spicy coconut?
As a white cis male, let me explain curry to you. I don't actually know. I just know it's delicious and I love it. And Tokyo Disneyland and DisneySea really has the market cornered on exotic, delightful popcorn flavors. Coconut being one of them, yes.
Really? That's fantastic.
Ooh, yes. And you can get there's a chain if you're in SoCal. There's a chain called the Mitsuha, and they sell the seasoning that they use at Tokyo Disneyland to season their popcorn. Hot tip right there.
Okay.
And what's the name of that place? The Mitsuha?
The Mitsuha. And there's a couple of locations in Southern California, and you can hunt it down. There's a curry seasoning there that you just mix with your popcorn and enjoy in your mouth.
Okay.
Wow. Okay. Now, the only thing that I'm finding online when I look up Mitsuha is a Hayao Miyazaki character. So I guess I'm looking in the wrong place.
Mitsawa.
Oh, M-I-T-S. This is really hard-hitting content for Sweep Spot listeners.
This is.
That's right. Yeah, I was going to say. So you guys worked on the Jungle Cruise, right?
Wait, we talked about ADHD, right?
Yeah, we covered it.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's really, it's kind of just the explanation as to why this is going to be the way it is.
Yes,
so, I mean, as far as Jungle Cruise goes, Dave, I don't know if I think I've told you this story. And maybe I haven't. Maybe I haven't. I haven't told the Sweep Spot listeners. Lynn, Ken, I haven't told you this. Kip, you may have heard this or not. But so when I first moved to California, I was a pool boy. I was cleaning swimming pools.
All right.
I know. That's my other podcast. It's called the Backside of Backyards. Well, it's a pool boy
from a pool family. Yes.
I was born a poor pool boy. But with that, quite literally, because it was like the family business. But when I was doing this, I wanted to work at Disneyland, and I had a buddy of mine who was... Wait, what university did you used to teach at, Dave?
Cal State Fullerton.
The one before that. Was it Vanguard?
Yeah, but we don't talk about that school because it's hot garbage.
Okay, well, this story is going to talk about that school in an adjacent way. Because that was the
if
first
you could
work
time. In some swears, that would be awesome.
Okay. I swear. So I was one of my friends, it was actually my ex-girlfriend's brother, was living and going to school out there, and he was like, I've got this professor who he used to work on the Jungle Cruise, and that's all he talks about. And so he was like, maybe we can talk to him and see what's going on. So I went up and met this professor, a young David Marley, and you talked to me about the Jungle Cruise for about 20 minutes, and then I left, and I just kept cleaning swimming pools for about 4 or 5 months. So, I mean, that was our first interaction, and clearly your pep talk really got me into the Jungle Cruise at that point.
Did it really?
I remember thinking, wow, this sounds awesome. Like, this is really cool. And then I left, and I didn't pursue working on the Jungle Cruise until like 4 months later, when really strange turn of events occurred that I was basically forced to go down to Disney. And I should say all the doors were closing, and I was like, I should just get a job at Disney. I've always wanted to do this. So I went down and said, hey, I want to work at the Jungle Cruise. And they were like, fill out this paperwork. And I filled out the paperwork, and they were like, okay, you're hired. But yeah, that was the first time that I met you, was outside the walls of Disney while you were a professor at Swear Garbage School.
That's right.
But yeah, that was one of my first experiences with a real life Jungle Cruise skipper outside of the jungle. So I, like I said, I don't know if I've ever told you that story or not.
No, I hadn't heard that.
That is very cool.
Yeah.
So thank you, Dave, for inspiring me, because you used to, if I recall, you had like a big Jungle Cruise poster that was like framed in your office, right?
My office was all Jungle Cruise and Marvel action figures.
Okay. Yeah.
And
so,
some Marx Brothers stuff, but that's it. It was all Disney stuff everywhere. Yeah.
Then that makes sense. That makes sense. So that was the first experience that I had. And then, yeah, I started working on the JC.
It's great that you share that, because I feel like that story balances the scales a little bit, because on the first episode, Dave shares a story about how he stole the Jungle Cruise from somebody in scheduling. They just deleted a human being and put his name in and ruined some poor soul's life.
Hey, I didn't steal anything. They did it. I was just standing there watching them delete some guy's name.
Wait, so you like requested you... Oh, did this come back to schoolyard violence again, Dave? Is this
got
him to do this for you?
I was working indie guest control, and one of the leads was like, yeah, you should be on Jungle. And I said, they won't train me. So he walked me over and said, put this guy on Jungle. And the training scheduling guy said, it's booked for the entire summer. There's no spots. And so my friend taps the screen. He goes, get rid of one of those guys and give it to Dave. And I watched the cursor go over, and they just deleted a guy's name and typed my name in. And 2 days later, the schedule came out, and I was getting drained at Jungle.
And that's how John Stamos didn't get a job at Jungle Cruise.
That's right. That's right.
I was going to say, and that person's name, Kip Hart.
He'd already been there 3 times before.
That's
though,
right.
So he was on his 4-3 hire in 96.
You're like that old grizzled veteran that keeps doing tours in Nam.
Yeah, that's right. Now I'm a mercenary. I'm a Jungle Cruise mercenary.
Yeah.
That's impressive. So Kip, what inspired you to leave this time? Or is it appropriate to talk about?
So no, it's totally fine. I needed day shifts. I mean, that's as simple as it was. I have a stand-up comedy endeavor that I'm really focusing on, and I can't do comedy at night if I'm working at Big Thunder Mountain or Jungle Cruise. So my rehire seniority was pretty low. Like, less than 3 years, maybe 3 years. And I converted to full-time, and so I couldn't get any day shifts. So, all the guys that on the day side from Big Thunder especially were all, 20, 30-year guys. So I was never going to see a day shift there for a long time. So I made the change. Comedy, the stand-up comedy is way more important to me than what I can do there at Disney. I mean, I love it there. I love the cast members. They're all my friends. But I'm really focused on this stand-up comedy thing.
Now, I'm curious about that, Kip. Sorry, Lynn. I hope I'm not totally, derailing this. My podcasting side is coming in.
No, you're fine.
The question, and I mean, honestly, I haven't really gotten a chance to just to sit down and, chew the fat with you guys, really, ever. I mean, Kip, it's been years since you and I have been able to chat. But I've never really asked this question, Kip. Chicken or the egg? Was it the Jungle Cruise that got you stoked about comedy? Were you stoked about comedy before the Jungle Cruise?
Well, it's actually, we're sitting here, and I'm sitting here in the presence of my mentor for stand-up comedy, David Marley. I'd never even thought about doing stand-up. I've always enjoyed comedy, but I'd never entertained the idea of doing stand-up. And then David was putting together this show called Skipper Stand-Up.
Mm.
Jungle Cruise skippers doing stand-up, and David asked me, he said, hey, we're putting together a show, I think you'd be good at it. write 8 minutes and let's see what happens. And that's the spark that got me started.
That's crazy. So it was the Jungle Cruise that kind of sparked that in a roundabout way.
The Jungle Cruise is a huge leg up. If you use it properly, it's a huge leg up on getting dialed in on a comedy mindset.
Mm-hmm.
The guest will tell you what you're doing wrong. If you listen to them, they'll let you know what you're doing wrong. And if you can be objective, you can use that to, you know, leverage your strength. You're doing 35 8-minute sets a day.
Yep.
You can't get that anywhere. You can't get that kind of stage time anywhere. It's a huge asset if you can be a skipper, and if you want to be stand up, it's. If you use it the right way, it's massive. I mean, it gives you, it's such a shortcut, it's unbelievable.
It's like a boot camp.
Yeah, totally. Oh, 100%.
Yep.
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, I think that was one of the things that was most intimidating. I don't know about for you guys, but for those who were listening, and I don't know, maybe this is a different experience now, Kip. I don't know if you can speak to that, but I would imagine, Trevor and Dave, this was what it was like when you guys were going through it, but there would be this time where they would just throw you up during your training. They would throw you up in front of people, and they'd say, okay, you're going for it now. And that's like your first experience giving a spiel on the Jungle Cruise. You don't really like sit in front of your two trainees or your trainer and your other trainee and be like, okay, this is what I'm going to say here and here. They were just like, okay, you got it. Go for it. And that was intimidating.
It's still the way they do it. Randy Grant was one of the best at it because he wouldn't let you know. As a trainer, all of a sudden you would you would pull up the load, you know, with your skipper trainee with you, and he would just give the signal, and they'd load it up, and you're like, oh my God, these people are getting in the boat, and you've got to tell them jokes.
That poor boat.
Training was always 3 days. And so on the second day, my trainees were like, are we going to have guests? And I always said the exact same lie. I'm like, you're going to have guests tomorrow. Don't worry about it today. Now, if they chose to interpret that as will be no guests today, that's not my fault. So I would wait till they were ready. When I thought they were ready, we'd pull up to the dock and I would just point down to the loaders would see me. I would point down and they'd start loading the boat. And the skippers would always look at me with just terror in their eyes.
That's beautiful.
And I had the same sentence, and I thought, if you weren't ready, I wouldn't have let people on the boat. And then I would just look down so that they could focus on dealing with the people.
When I was doing the training, I was like a put me in coach kind of kid. I was nothing but excited to work it because I always wanted to.
Yeah.
And so I feel like, not to toot my own horn here, did pretty good job on the first pass.
Yeah.
And then the other trainee was this cat named, I think his name's Kevin Campbell. And
don't say his last name.
Oh,
yeah. Who knows?
Okay, we'll edit that out. His name was Stacy Johnson.
That's right.
Wait, you just said Kevin Campbell.
Oh, Kevin Campbell. Okay, yeah. I don't know. He could be anywhere.
I mean, is this a bad story? Or is this
it's
like...
It's a great story.
Okay, so that he's going to be glorified in that.
I wouldn't want my last name attached to this story if I was Kevin Campbell.
He was fantastic in that, whereas I like really did my due diligence and wanted to like just nail the jokes. He was more of a just a entity that moved through jungle. And I think we counted 12 different accents that he moved through in his first tour. And he didn't even know after we asked him, like, what was with the Russian accent? He's a Russian accent. He was phenomenal. It was like watching Andy Kaufman unintentionally do a Jungle Cruise tour.
I think that's a question that I have is, what do you guys have a memory of like your worst boat?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Like one that you just bombed hard.
Oh, yeah. Man.
Narrow it down. Narrow it down.
I'm telling you, there's, you know, yes. Okay, so here's a story. It was during Christmas time. And, you know, it's hard to have a perspective of time, but it seemed like it was 2 weeks of just bad boats every night.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. But it was probably 2 days, you know, but it just, you know.
It feels like a lifetime.
Piling up on you. And so one night during Christmas, I left the dock, and I used to tell this joke. I can't remember what joke it was. They kind of test the boat out, see where they were at. and nothing. They said absolutely nothing. There was no reaction, and I turned around and I said, "That's right, kid. There's no Santa Claus."
Oh.
And I thought at that very moment, I said, "Oh my God, I just lost my job."
It was a great last day.
So anyway, so it's funny because so we kept going and we got into the shrine and I told a couple more jokes and they weren't having it. They were already pretty angry. And then I started singing Santa Claus is Coming to Town. And then I said, but now we know he's not coming.
This is so aggressive.
I just doubled down.
Wow.
And anyway, nothing, obviously nothing happened because I was still there. So, but anyway, so that's
the hired 13 more times.
Yeah, ironically, it led to guest compliments.
Yes.
We're going to get angry letters.
That's funny how that happens too, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, did anybody have like a response? I'm curious when you delivered this spot. Kip is
there
just
was a mom sitting there next to me. She said, "Watch it." I mean, she was angry. It's justified, you know. It was a crazy thing to say, but anyway.
Yeah.
It's hard not to get grumpy though. I mean, honestly, you're laying your soul out trying to get some laughs. I mean, it's not like it's not a selfish thing that's like, "Hey, look at me." You're really trying to give people a great experience, and when it's met with just pure silence, or you know, I could deal with silence. But to me, it was the indifference. That was the thing that really got me. Yes, silence is fine because maybe it's getting something through and they're just not receptive. I mean, because that was my experience. My hardest boat of all time was I only had one celebrity boat in my entire life, and it was me and Ice Cube in the boat.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
That's
and
so cool.
It was cool until you have just Ice Cube in the boat. And you realize, you're like, man, I think that I'm funny and life is silly. And now I'm talking to the founder of NWA, and this is getting intense. And I'm just in the jungle in Anaheim. And so I just, like, I gave it my all. And there was not one single laugh. Not one single laugh through the entire boat. And he gets, right as I get to the end, he stands up and he comes over to me. He's like, "You're a pretty funny guy," and then just walks off the boat.
Wow. I guess you never know.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, the silence is fine. It's the indifference. Like, if he was just totally texting or talking to a friend or something like that, that was the thing that crushed my soul, was just the apathy.
Yep. Was now forgive me for my ignorance on the rap scene. Was Ice Cube West Coast or East Coast?
West Coast.
Oh, well,
right out of Compton.
Yeah. He's from
Compton. Yeah, he's like,
I know.
Local guy.
That's weird that he didn't enjoy it.
What was your worst boat?
My worst boat? There's been several million. but the one that springs to mind immediately. Well, there's two. All right, so I primarily worked nights, which was fantastic because it was a light crowd, and you can get away with a lot of stuff. And so I remember two tours distinctly that did not play well outside of the people that were involved in it, the skippers in the boat. We had one called a Muppet tour that we only did once, where we unraveled a bunch of wire hangers and wrapped them around my wrists, and I would be puppeteered in the front of the boat while another skipper did the tour, and they didn't care for that. The people on the boat did not like that. And then the other one was the Mad Hatter tour, where I just talked like the Mad Hatter the whole time. Did the normal tour, but talked like the Mad Hatter, like "Oh yeah," and just did that the whole time
for 10 minutes.
Yeah, 10 minutes at night, and people weren't having it. And that was the one time that the lead at the time, who shall remain name? I've learned my lesson. I'm not naming names.
His name was Kevin Campbell.
That's right, Kevin Campbell.
Leave it, Kevin Campbell hashtag on this episode, please.
There was a lady that was livid by the end of the Mad Hatter tour for some reason, because I wasn't even doing bad jokes. It was just in the Mad Hatter voice. She went up and yelled at the lead. The lead came over and said, "That lady is furious." And he's like shaking his finger at me. And he says, I'm pretending like I'm giving you a talking to, so just look really sad right now, and then she hopefully won't go to City Hall, which was a real solid on their part.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Way to go, Kevin.
That's right.
Yeah. Totally redeemed.
That was, that was Benny.
Oh, Benny. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I saw him do that more than once. Yeah.
Benny was a stellar lead.
Yes, yes. I watched him. I am yelling at you, and you are to look sad. Look sad.
That's
I'm
right.
Yelling. Are they still watching? Because I'm yelling.
I love that about the crew. Happy.
I got that guy in trouble.
That's right.
Yeah.
So, Dave, what was your worst?
I also had several, but the first that popped to mind, my very worst boat and my very best boat were literally back to back. The first grad night I ever worked. I had no idea what to expect. I'd been working there less than a month. The boat fills up with kids evidently from rival high schools that spent the ride screaming at each other. And these two girls got into a fist, like started swinging hands over the middle of the boat. And they're swearing. And I floored it. This boat was full speed the whole way through. I just stopped doing jokes by the elephant pool. Like I just raced through and I get back to the dock. And this girl goes, "You didn't even do any jokes." And I went, "Get out. Everybody out, everybody out." And I just, that was my get out spiel, was get out, everybody out, everybody out. And I thought, I can't do this. I can't do this. I'm not. And the next boat, I pull up and I'm shaking and I cracked one joke and they all started laughing and applauding. And I'm like, what? And I did a few more. Every joke I said was gold. And at the end, they stood up and gave me a standing ovation and they came and took their pictures with me. And then I got bumped out. And the manager's there. He's like, "Hey, how's your first grad night going?" And I said, "I have no idea." no idea.
It's just a myriad of emotions. That's impressive.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a wild night.
They were all drunk.
No, in the beginning of the night, they're not drunk. Later on, they're drunk and they just want to sleep on the boat.
That's right.
And you're like, "I'll drive slow so you can sleep." They're like, "Yay."
I did one grad night and I wasn't even scheduled. I just wanted to do a grad night so bad that I just stayed.
Just showed up.
I did. I just didn't leave that day. And we had this bit where we called it the party boat. It was me and Rit and a couple other skips. And we had a boom box that solely played Janet Jackson.
"All the guys in the party."
That song. We played it over the speaker in the boat the entire time and just would flick the lights on and off and scream "party boat." And we danced outside the boat for like 10
I bet they minutes. Loved it. I bet that was huge.
They were confused and thrilled at the same time.
Wow.
Which, speaking of which, I feel like that's the thing that a lot of people don't realize about a Jungle Cruise skipper is you find yourself in this situation where some of these things are great and some of them are terrible, and then you find yourself in emergency situations where your boat's not the one in an emergency situation, but you're in line behind boats that are in an emergency situation, and you're forced to sit there in the middle of the jungle with a microphone in front of 40 strangers. And sometimes this takes 20, 30 minutes. I mean, my record was 60 minutes on a boat with people while there was somebody having a psychotic break on a boat in front of us. And that will definitely like prove your worth as a human being in that moment. Did you guys ever have any experiences like that where you were like stranded in the jungle and you were forced to entertain while they were stuck?
Well, first of all, I don't appreciate you bringing up my psychotic break on the Jungle Cruise.
Come on, man.
I told Kevin I wouldn't bring it up, but he's integral to that story.
At the beginning, when you're a new skipper, the idea of that is terrifying. And then after you're there for a couple months, you're like, "Man, I need to. Let's hope for a breakdown. I could do some material."
Right.
My record was 45 minutes, and I just went and just did every joke I could think of and was just telling wild stories. I loved a good downtime.
I can honestly say
it's the partial nudity that really.
I did full frontal.
Oh yeah.
But it was tasteful. It was tasteful.
It was tasteful. I used fig leaves.
It's actually in the union rules. Once you pass 30 minutes, you can take off clothing.
You can
every 15 minutes.
You can take
as long as it's like show appropriate.
Special, or are you just glad to see me?
I would wrap myself with leaves. It was appropriate.
We called it the Big Bertha tour.
I will actually say that boat that broke down, that was probably my best boat that I've ever had. And I don't know if it's because they're like, "Oh, this poor kid, he's trying." But, like, it was, I felt like I killed that entire time I was out in the jungle. And I don't know if it's because it was an awkward situation and people were just trying to, you know, release that tension through laughter, but it was one of my greatest boats, without a doubt.
Because it's such a unique experience. Where else are you going to get to hang out with a jungle cruise or with a cast member for like 10, 15, 20 minutes in the middle of a jungle? It's like such a rare thing. I think guests get kind of a thrill out of it.
Oh, yeah.
It's so unique. And then I loved a good downtime.
Oh, absolutely. Well,
in that experience, it was one of those that it was so intense that they actually had us reverse to get back to the dock. Oh, yeah. And so not only were they stuck out there with me, but they also got to see things in reverse. So I did my spiel in reverse. And if you watch it back on the video, I actually did it perfectly. And I just kept saying over and over, Paul is dead. Paul is dead.
Nice.
And yeah, I mean, I'll say this. You can check it out on Spotify, but it's a little bit underground. You'll have to search for it.
What is
cool?
The Beatles? I'm like, wait, I thought you were going to tell us what it was called or what it is.
No, my spiel, guys. My spiel is on Spotify. It was a failed bit is what that was. Okay. I didn't actually do my spiel backwards on the Jungle Cruise. That's an impossibility.
You could have. Kevin Campbell probably could have done it.
I've seen Kevin Campbell do that several times.
Several times.
Kevin, I will never live up to Campbell. I cannot have Campbell status forever now.
Can I
just say that that silence that you guys all had, that bewildered silence at the end of that story, was literally how every boat ended for me?
Well, I don't know how it all ended, but we were all looking at each other like, how do we address this?
We don't know what to say about any of this.
And that's exactly what was going on. So again, when you talk about ADHD, that, you know, when you get on a trail and you realize that you talk about something in reverse and you listen to a Beatles record in reverse and you hear that supposedly Paul is dead, you got to connect those two, even if it's not going to work. You still have to commit to that, and we all have to admit that even though there's been times that we knew that it wasn't going to work on the Jungle Cruise, but we had to commit and see it through, and that was my moment here in life.
I mean, I always tried to do Paula's Dead bits, Billy Shear bits. I'd go on barefoot, and I'd get yelled at. I tried a bit based on your bit. here's my problem. I tried a bit based on a failed bit.
You're all just staring at you like
that's a bad launching bit. My ADHD brain literally said, "What are you doing? Why are you going down this path?"
It's apex when one of us does a Yoko Ono joke. That's when them all know it's time to move on.
I just did an entire boat once where I was just going, have you guys seen Get Back, by the way? Sorry, I cannot ADHD that far.
It is so good.
It's great. That's what I was just thinking is when Yoko and John are just going off the rails on that song and she's just making these impressive sounds and you just see the shock and just indifference on everybody's face. Again, that's exactly what my quote was.
Singing career.
Well, you know what's weird about when you watch Get Back is that she got a bum rap for a long time, breaking up the Beatles. She's sitting in the corner. Yeah. I would say George bringing them the Krishnas every couple of days was more of a distraction.
Yeah.
They're sitting in the corner, judging, staring.
The bald heads and the vegan meals and the whatnot. All I know about them is what I remember from Airplane. That's all I remember.
Oh, okay.
Airplane films.
One of the greatest jungle days of my life, and I don't know how well it played, was Kip in one of his many retirement periods.
Oh, yeah. It's a good story.
Allowed me to spiel. And I'm sure you'll agree, every skipper's dream is to go into the park, wander into the park, and somebody goes, "Hey, you want to take the mic for this next tour?"
Wait, so you were in your civvies?
I was just a plainclothes guest.
Oh, wow.
Should I not tell the story if you try to go back?
You want to tell it?
I mean, I can.
Just tell him, Kevin. Kevin Campbell.
We did it a couple times.
Well, that's going to conclude part one of our roundtable discussion. We will have part two coming up on the next main topic episode. But don't leave now. We have some other things coming up. Wow, what an episode.
Yeah, I'm sorry that I kept interjecting and wouldn't let them talk, but
it was great. Yeah, thank you to everyone that came on. That was a lot of fun. I just was sitting back, just listening to a bunch of old friends talking about their time working on the Jungle Cruise and more. We talked about a variety of things, didn't we?
Yeah, that was an interesting discussion, and I hope the listeners really enjoyed that and learned some new things and got some insight into that whole phenomenon of being a Jungle Cruise skipper.
Yeah, for sure. We have a new review I wanted to read, as we always do. And this was on August 19th, 5 stars, and it's, again, the whole title gets chopped off on this app. Highlights the... And then it's over. It's by J Pod Blue, and it says, this is long, so I'm going to read this, so it's good.
Okay.
I started listening to the Sweep Spot 2 months ago when I was looking for a Disney podcast. Not knowing it highlights the history and behind the scenes of Disneyland, it is now my favorite Disney-related podcast. I love learning from the host and guests. My favorite so far is Wendy James and how she extends the Disney magic into the school district.
Are you sure we didn't read this one already?
She now leads as a custodian.
Oh.
Right? This podcast, I don't know if we did, but if we did.
You know what I'm thinking of? I think I read it on my own. I don't know if you've read it on the show, so.
All right.
Anyway,
well, I'm going to continue. You know what?
Even if we had it in the previous episode, it doesn't matter. We need to read this one.
Yes. So let me finish. This podcast has taught me Disney is all around us, and the lasting influences Disneyland has on technology, engineering, culture, and joy in Southern California and around the world. Thank you to the hosts for their time and energy. I just bought their books and excited to read them. Well,
we need to read that every episode because it's a really good review.
Yeah, so that will be the way we end every episode. No. Thank you so much again. If we did read it twice, it's funny. Like, we record these shows, and as soon as we're done, I edit, put them out. You know, in the way that we put them out in the order. But my mind's already on the next show or the next three shows. You know,
yeah.
So. Sometimes I forget what happened. So, and after, 342, it's hard to keep up. So, yeah. Thank you guys for listening. I really appreciate it. And we will bring you more coming up next time.
If you're at D23, come see us and spread the word. Tell people how they can find the podcast.
Yes. Thank you again. And we'll talk to you next time.